the magic of the word and the sound forever. I believe now they come around and ask me, yeah. Tell them he's the children of Judah. Break a rubber chain and the ruler. Everybody's praying, everybody doing it, everybody say, yeah.
Champion arrive, we shall win. Champion arise, we shall win. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. We're stronger and alive, we shall win. Let another spiritual war begin.
Don't you believe everything that you've been told? We can be bought for shekels, feed that with silver and gold. Across the land, I know that my story will be told. Coming from the young, coming from the old. And the mountains to the west, we conquered every fear and passed every test. Converging from the cities, converging from the villages, converging from all across the land. Tell them it's the giant ruler, I and I are as a ruler. Everybody saying, everybody singing, everybody rising. The champion arise, we shall win. Champion arise, we shall win. Oh, 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 oh. Champion arise, we shall win. Let another spiritual war begin.
Oh, oh, here we come.
Yet another spiritual warfare. Another spiritual war.
Oh, here we come.
Fight on, fight on.
Champion arise.
Joshua send another champion.
A champion arise.
Show us the way. Yeah,
yeah. Champion arise. We shall win.
Joshua send Elijah.
Welcome, everyone, and thank you for being here. I am Angela Grimes. I'm the CEO of Born Free USA, and today we are celebrating the future of wildlife and the natural world. And there is hope. There is hope for wildlife and hope for the future because of people like you who are joining us today and every day to help support our work to save the lives of animals. As you were coming on, you heard Champions Arise by Rocky DAWUNI. And you saw on the screen wishes for the future of wildlife and wishes of hope that were sent in by many of you who are here with us today and other supporters who had registered for this event. Rocky, the singer, is a Grammy-nominated Ghanaian-born Afro-roots reggae musician. He's also a Goodwill ambassador and a member of Born Free USA's Honorary Council. He uses his music and his considerable talents to shine a light on crucial issues facing humanity around the globe. We've got a wonderful lineup for you all today, and I want to jump right into that with our star-studded lineup, beginning with a message from Rocky DAWUNI himself.
Hello, everybody. My name is Rocky DAWUNI, musician, United Nations Goodwill Ambassador for Environment for Africa, and Honorary Council Member for Born Free USA. I am really happy that we are all united today to draw attention and shed light on wildlife issues around the world. The song that you just heard It's called Champion Arise. And when I wrote the song, the purpose of the song was to really inspire people to aspire to their greatest self, regardless of whatever impediment they're confronted with. And this is the state of wildlife today in the world. But I want to take this opportunity to also give you a message of hope. Born Free USA is doing incredible work on the ground to bring attention to wildlife and wildlife habitats. As long as we have positive people working together, we know we're definitely gonna overcome this. So enjoy the energy of this function the next hour. And I look forward to all of us keeping the fight going and bringing attention and making sure that through our works, we protect wildlife around the world. Thank you very much. God bless you. Peace and love.
Thank you, Rocky, for sharing your gift of music and that beautiful message with everyone. Born Free was founded on the principles of compassion and ensuring a future for wildlife. And it's no coincidence that our name shares the name of an iconic film, Born Free. That film told the true story of an orphaned lioness who was rehabilitated and released back to the wild. And it starred two of our founders, Virginia McKenna and Bill Travers, who played the real life Adamsons. And it was their experience working on that film, along with a subsequent film, An Elephant Called Slowly, that inspired the couple and their son Will to start campaigning to free their elephant co-star, Pole Pole, from the London Zoo. Their work grew into a global organization, the one we are today, with programs helping wildlife, their habitats, and people living on five continents. We'll be hearing from Virginia McKenna later on, along with other dedicated supporters and activists. And we're very pleased to have Will Travers himself, president of Born Free, as our host. Will, welcome and thank you.
Well, thank you, Angela. And I just want to add my own special welcome to everyone who is joining us on this amazing Hope for Wildlife Gala event in aid of Born Free USA. There's many reasons, I have to tell you, to be hopeful for wildlife. The passion that our supporters have, and the changes in the world that we're seeing. We have some tremendous support from our board, from our honorary council, and some extremely talented friends of Born Free, some of whom you'll be meeting this evening. There's you, our fantastic audience. There's Dr. Liz Tyson, who will offer reasons also why we have hope for wildlife at Born Free, because of our ongoing work to protect animals wherever they're in need. We have some messages and appearances by the co-founder of Born Free, just happens to be my mum, Virginia McKenna. We have the beautiful and talented actresses Abigail Spencer and CARLA FRASER, and a live performance from the exceptional singer, songwriter, and musician TIGER DARROW, plus some special surprises. Now, you all know, if you don't know by now, today is Giving Tuesday, and I hope that you will join us in supporting our efforts to create a better future for wildlife. I need to tell you that if you are going to generously support us, there are some special benefits that we can offer you. The first five people who donate $150 will receive a copy of my mum's memoir, The Life in My Years. It'll be signed by Virginia. It will have a personal message to you. You say what you want in it. It could be for you, it could be for your loved one, it could be for a friend, and we'll send that to you. It's going to come from the UK, so allow for some postal delays there. If you donate $250 or more, you're going to be eligible for one of Dr. Liz Tyson, you're going to meet her soon, four digital images that she's created. There's Billy the Vervet, and there is Darwin the Baboon. There is a wonderful picture of Gurma the lion, and there is a wild elephant courtesy of a photograph sent in by our patron, Dan Richardson. And these are all going to be framed. Then the first five people who donate $500 or more, Liz will create a custom digital image of a companion dog, cat, or any other animal. And I look there and I see My very own Virginia and I share a dog, Romy, rescued from Romania, and there he is. And I suspect that the other dog is familiar to one of our guests who will be coming on later. Now, if you donate $1,000, here's the exciting thing. You can have virtual tea with Liz, and slightly less exciting, you can have virtual tea with me, and we might even do a virtual tea together, but you'd have to come up with a little bit more for that one. And then finally, the first lucky person who donates $5,000 will be offered an opportunity to visit the Primate Sanctuary in Texas. That includes domestic economy airfare and accommodation for two nights. And it's for the first $5,000 donor only. And look, there at the bottom of that is the detail where you can make donations, bornforusa.org/hope. And hope is what it's all about. And for a message of hope, no, wait a sec. There's one more thing to mention, and that is everyone who donates just $50 gets the chance of having a special treat, but I'm not going to reveal what it is. And I'm not even going to tell you about my bananas, which are for the monkeys down at the Primate Sanctuary. So I'm now going to give you a message from my mum, Virginia McKenna, who has recorded this especially for this evening.
A very warm welcome to you all, and thank you so much for joining us at the Hope for Wildlife event. I'm Virginia McKenna, and I'm the co-founder of Born Free. More than 50 years ago, the path of my life was changed forever. When my husband, Bill Travers, our children and I traveled to Kenya to film the movie Born Free, based on Joy Adamson's best-selling book, which told the story of Elsa the Lioness and her journey to freedom. Our experience living and working with wild animals on the film, and later with a young elephant, Poli Poli, inspired us to devote our lives to fighting animal cruelty and working for the protection of wildlife through our charity, Born Free. These are some of the most challenging times we've ever experienced since we launched Born Free 36 years ago. Each and every one of us has been affected. No one is immune. However, I always remain hopeful for the future. We will come out of this crisis, and we will rebuild a healthier, more compassionate world. I believe there are many reasons to be encouraged. Born Free started with six people sitting around a kitchen table with $10 in the 1980s. And now, in 2020, we are a global organization, influencing and bringing about change at the highest levels. We are effectively fighting the illegal wildlife trade, achieving greater legal protection for wild animals in the US and on the global stage, championing the innovative investment in nature, and rescuing and rehabilitating many hundreds of individual animals in sanctuaries around the world. Just think of what Born Free can do in the next 35 years. I have hope because my son Will has been with Born Free from the beginning and continues to lead its vision of compassionate conservation, guided by our belief in the intrinsic value of individual animals. I have hope because of the great leadership of Angela Grimes, Born Free USA's CEO, and our dedicated teams of professionals. I have hope because of the talented, enthusiastic expertise and professionalism of lifelong animal advocate Dr. Liz Tyson, who runs Born Free USA's Primate Sanctuary and leads our wider programmatic work. I have hope because of our dedicated, loyal teams in the US, the UK, Canada, Kenya, Ethiopia, South Africa, Sri Lanka, and all around the world. And I have hope because of you, our loyal friends and supporters, each of whom stands with us and makes our vital animal protection programs possible. Together, I believe we will come out of this crisis stronger, with greater respect for and appreciation of the natural world, united in our common effort to build back better. That's why I will always have hope for wildlife.
Well, goodness me, I call me biased, but I'm always inspired when I hear my mum talk, because she talks with such incredible passion about something she cares so deeply about. And I feel, not that it's my duty, it's my honor to be supporting her vision of that kinder, better world. And you saw in that little montage of photographs, a photograph of Dr. Liz Tyson, someone else who inspires me. Liz, we're going to talk now with Liz. And Liz is Born Free USA's programs director, and she's helped animals across the globe. She helped to establish the first locally run sterilization program for street dogs in the Middle East. She worked with indigenous communities in the Colombian Amazon to end the hunting of wild primates. And she ran a UK charity herself, campaigning to end the exploitation of animals in circuses and zoos. In 2018, she earned her doctorate in animal law, and she recently published her book, Licensing Laws and Animal Welfare, The Legal Protection of Wild Animals, with Palgrave, Macmillan and Springer. It is my great pleasure to welcome Liz, my friend Liz. And Liz, tell us a little bit about the work that you do. I have some questions.
I will. Thank you so much. Thank you everyone so much for being here. It means so much to us. What a strange, challenging year it's been. I think, but today, of course, is all about hope, what gives us hope. And I want to start by talking about a little monkey called Mrs. Wilkin, who this year has given my team and me great hope. She came from a horrible, horrible roadside zoo called Cricket Hollow, which was heroically shut down by the Animal Legal Defence Fund after a long legal battle. They chose our sanctuary to send five monkeys to, Mrs. Wilkin, Anna, Marlin, Violet, and Presley. But the thing about Mrs. Wilkin was she was slightly different. She's in her late 20s. We actually don't really know how old she is. We're not even sure what species she is. She's an odd looking little monkey because she wasn't given the correct nutrition growing up. So she has all sorts of bone deformities. She has an old break in her jaw, so she can't close her mouth properly. She has tumors, she has pain issues. Honestly, when we saw her medical records on paper, we didn't know if she'd survived the journey to come to the sanctuary. Boy, did she prove us wrong. She arrived in January. The first thing she did, we didn't quite get her food to her quick enough. She was still in her transport cage. She had her water. She was furious that we were not moving more quickly than we were, and she threw her water at us. And that was the beginning of our relationship with Mrs. Wilkin. She is honestly right now in end-of-life care. She is at the end of her life, but the way that she has grasped this time that she has left, spending time with her friend Anna, quarreling with her neighbors, stomping around her enclosure, sunbathing, enjoying what she has left and making the absolute most of the opportunity, has given us huge hope during this year. And she's just one of 430 something monkeys we care for, all with their own stories.
Well, you see, that's the thing, isn't it, Liz? I mean, we focus at Born Free on the needs of the individual. We recognize that individual animals all have their individual needs, their own individual desires, characteristics, characters. But beyond the individual, it's these bigger campaigning issues. For example, fur farming. I know that that's high on your agenda.
Absolutely. We've actually just released a really important report into fur farming, the most comprehensive study of the practice in the US in the last 10 years. Honestly, we couldn't have known the timing would be so apt, because I'm sure many of you already know that there have been significant outbreaks of COVID-19 around fur farms around the world, devastating for the individual animals affected. But what that has actually triggered is the closing down of the fur farm industry across the globe. So that gives us hope. We've seen the fur farm industry in Poland close down in the last few months. We've seen the fur farming industry in Denmark on its knees and taking its last breath. So here in the US, fur farming isn't a huge industry. It affects millions of animals, but comparable to other European countries, where it is a major economic interest, if we're seeing countries like Poland, the largest fur farmer in the world, shut down its industry, that gives us hope that our work here in the US can follow the same direction. So we're going to be focusing on that really hard this coming year, focusing on state level legislation and also hopefully beginning to work on federal level changes so that we can also close the door on that barbaric industry that affects so many millions of animals every year.
So, and it's not just about, I mean, not just, it's not only about the legislative reform that's necessary. It is about changing consumer decisions, consumer choices, attitudes are changing. People are walking away from fur. But in a related subject, Born for USA also focuses on trapping. And I think, I mean, there is this horrendous statistic concerning trapping on public lands. Mm-hmm. And I don't think enough people know about this. Just explain to us what on earth is going on.
Absolutely. So we have a system here in the US, the National Wildlife Refuge System. The clue's in the name. It should be a wildlife refuge. All animals there should be protected. In fact, trapping is mandated and indeed carried out both recreationally and by government officials within the National Wildlife Refuge System on 11.1 million acres of public land. What that means is not only are wildlife not safe within the refuge system, which just beggars belief, but what it also means is those people who go to these places as tourists, as visitors who go, they take their companion animal for a walk, they think that they're contributing to this protected area where everybody's safe. In fact, if your dog managed to get off the leash, there is every chance that in those areas where trapping is allowed, your dog may also become victim to this, alongside, of course, the wildlife who are deliberately targeted. So we currently have a petition to the Department of Interior. We managed to get 10,000 signatures in the first month of this campaign, which is amazing. But we will also be starting to work on, again, federal level legislation in the coming year to try and get that banned. It's ridiculous that this barbaric practice is allowed in what should be protected areas. Of course, we want a ban on trapping across the country. We're not just looking at protected areas. We want this to come to an end. This is absolutely archaic. It should never be allowed to happen. There's nothing humane about it, and the suffering it causes is absolutely unacceptable. So, but we're confident that bringing it to the light, to public awareness, then we will be able to make some changes in the coming year, either at state level and hopefully at federal level.
And I think it's, you know, regardless of one's politics, I think this is one of those issues that crosses the aisle, that allows people of compassion from whichever political persuasion they come to unite, to make sure that in places that are called wildlife refuges, animals are safe. Your companion animal is, your child is safe. It seems unconscionable that it is allowed, and I'm sure it will unite people from all different parts of the political spectrum at the federal level. Coming back down though to the specifics, because you actually live on site down at the primate sanctuary in Texas, in a sort of remote-ish part of Texas. I've been a few times myself, Virginia's been as well. It is extraordinary what you and the team do down there. I mean, what are the priorities for you down there right now?
Well, right now we are at capacity. Now, unfortunately, as you can imagine, there are unfortunately so many different ways that the primates can be exploited, whether that's in zoos, in the pet trade, in labs. Millions of animals every year are in that, currently in that situation. We can save but a handful of them. And right now we can't even do that because we're at capacity. We have enclosures which currently need completely replacing because where existing residents live, those enclosures have come to the end of their useful lives. We also have plans in the coming year to hopefully build new enclosures. If we can do that, we always have a waiting list. We have monkeys right now who need a home and we can't offer it to them. So we're really hoping in the coming year that those needs can be fulfilled so that we can begin to rescue again. Of course, for us as kind of animal rescuers, rehabilitators, that is the thing that gives us the most hope, you know, so that we can rescue more Mrs. Wilkins, so we can rescue more Marlins and Annas and give them that second chance at life.
Yeah, and I know that, you know, time is short on this gala evening, on this Hope for Wildlife evening, but, you know, you're dealing with the sharp end, you're dealing with those animals and their lives on a daily basis. But again, it goes kind of back upstream to the legislative side of things, because we want to see change. We want to see the Captive Primate Safety Act, for example, enacted so that we begin to choke off the supply. mean, we'll deal with it for as long as we can, but we need to choke off the supply of animals, of primates, into those facilities, because the one thing we want to do, frankly, is put ourselves out of business. I won't go into what we do in Canada. We do a whole mass of work in Canada on the culling of wildlife. We also work extensively in West Africa, supported by the US government, on building capacity for many of the countries in the West African region to improve their wildlife law enforcement work, to carry out better customs investigations, to do wildlife trade investigations, to clamp down on the source of wildlife products as well. So taking all that into account, Liz, what gives you hope for wildlife?
I think certainly everybody watching today, our work is because of you. We cannot do anything that we do without your support. I think also, and you touched on this just now, well, I think the fact Wolfrey covers every base. And you know, there is huge value to every sanctuary, every person working on legislative change, every person taking streets and doing their bit. But what makes me really proud and hopeful with Born Free is that we do it all. We look after the monkeys here at the sanctuary. We fight for legislation as well. We're really covering the entire spectrum. We have Elise and her team. You'll hear a little bit from her later on one of the videos we have, you know, fighting wildlife trafficking at the source. And that's so important. And just being part of Born Free, being part of the family, the team, and obviously our wider family of donors and supporters, is just gives me a huge amount of hope. So you've been asking me all the questions, Will. I'm going to turn it right back on you now. We are living in incredibly difficult times in terms of the environment, conservation, the challenges we face in every area of life. So what gives you hope for wildlife?
Well, I'll tell you one thing that does, and this is now going to the macro scale. I worked with 19 other conservation organizations. So Born Free was right in there with some of the very biggest names, from the Nature Conservancy to Conservation International, WWF and more. Only about a week and a half ago, we produced a declaration called the WC20 Declaration, which was presented to the G20. And what it basically said in a few words is, if we don't scale up our investment in nature and our protection of natural resources, the wild, biodiversity, ecosystems, and the ecosystem services, which ultimately we are all dependent upon, then there really is no hope. But my hope is that, in a sense, the horrors of the pandemic, which are afflicting the United States perhaps as badly as anywhere in the world, that the horrors of the pandemic have brought us to our senses just before we push ourselves and the rest of life on Earth over a cliff, and that we will step back, engage reverse, and think about how we create a much more sustainable, compassionate, and caring future for all life forms, not just ourselves. That's what gives me hope. Liz, it's been an absolute pleasure, as always. One day, perhaps, if we're allowed, I will return to the US and I will come down to the sanctuary one more time to say hi in person. But it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And thank you everyone watching. We've got some more great stuff coming up. So really grateful that you're all here with us today.
So everybody, that's Dr. Liz Tyson, an outstanding individual, but I'm gonna take you to another outstanding individual, our next guest. Now, I met Tiger Darrow when she was very young, a teenager, at a wedding with her lovely mum, Peyton Hayslip, who I think is tuned in. I hope she's tuned in tonight, fingers crossed. Tiger is an award-winning singer-songwriter. She's a multi-instrumentalist, she's a producer, she's an actress, and she began her career training to be a classical cellist. She crafts her songs with intricate string arrangements and distorted beats, and fusing both aggression and a delicacy that's quite remarkable. There's too much for me to tell you about Tiger, but I will tell you that it's not often that we meet somebody who has opened for the Eagles, for example, or Erica Badu, or Eddie Brickle and the New Bohemians. So without further ado, I want to introduce you to both Tiger Darrow and three New York-based cellists, Sasha Ono, Aya Turkey, and Lydia Palos. And I hope I pronounced that right. And then after Tiger has performed her song, Tears and Chocolate, I'm gonna ask her a couple of questions. So over to you, Tiger.
Thank you so much.
I just want my empire. I just wanna be the queen. Want you with me starting fires. Baddest besties on the scene. Cause only you could take my hand and say you understand. And make me believe. I know that our love is pure. So sugar, honey, let's get it. We know anything a man can't cure can be solved with tears and chocolate. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. Oh. Drinking red wine in bed, crying over stupid things he said. You're putting Kanye on so we can dance, and then for weeks the songs are stuck in our heads. And you make it so clear for me that you'll be there when no one else can be. Ooh, I know that our love is pure. So sugar, honey, let's get lit. We know anything a man can't cure can be solved with tears and chocolate. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. Oh, you're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. Oh, someday when we say goodbye, promise we won't cry. Cause when it rains, it'll come down diamonds on high. We'll be the rulers of the sky. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. Oh, you're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. You're my best, you're my best, you're my best friend. You're my best, you're my best. Oh, I know that our love is pure. So sugar, honey, let's get lit. We know anything a man can cure can be solved with tears and chocolate.
Thank you very much, Tiger and the trio. That's fantastic. I sort of feel like you should be on the Graham Norton show. You probably don't know what the Graham Norton show is, but that would definitely go with the Graham Norton show. And if only everything in the world could be solved with tears and chocolate.
If only, you know.
If only.
That's what the universe is missing.
I think it's true. Now, listen, Mike, I have a question for you because, you know, I am of a certain age, by which I mean that I will never see 40, 50, 60 again. There is a real groundswell of both excitement and I think anger and I think trepidation about the future coming from young people. And as a young person, what do you think it is that is making that, not just the generation after me, but sort of two generations after me, what is making people so focused on Extinction Rebellion and all these other activities right now?
I think we're just getting much closer to the point of no return. And I feel like my generation and the generation after our generation are realizing that, like, if people don't hurry up and do something about it. I mean, then what are like my kids or their kids or my grandchildren, whichever, what does the world look like for them at that point? And so it's, you know, decades upon decades of just kind of brushing things under the rug. And finally, my generation has, honestly, I think technology has really helped my generation stay on top of what's actually going on and keeping us engaged and active in it. I know I get a lot of my news from social media, which maybe isn't the healthiest way to do it. And I definitely do my fact checking. Ha. But that is a huge part of it, is that our generation is the generation of social media, and we can help make movements spread like wildfire through that. And I think that's really important.
I think that's really a good analysis. And of course, I would say that if you ever want to find out kind of what's going on, then come to Born Free USA's social media, where you'll get the picture with no frills or embellishment. You know, it's been estimated, there was a report out earlier this summer, 1 million species are now facing extinction. Faced with that, you know, the obvious question I'm asking everybody this is, what gives you hope for wildlife in the future? Is it the young generation? Is it activism? Is it a redistribution of our efforts and our resources towards wildlife?
I think it's a little bit of all of the above. Definitely organizations like Born Free and how younger generations can get involved with Born Free and other organizations that do similar work. I think that's a huge thing that gives me hope. Seeing how my friends are so passionate about like social issues and world issues, that inspires me greatly and helps me feel like, okay, great, we're all motivated to make this happen. So let's get out there and make our voices heard and do what we can, donate where we can, show up for things. You know, I think that's what gives me the most hope.
Well, I just want to say a huge thank you for showing up, as you just said. For your talent and the talent of the trio, would you please take your music and use your music as a weapon of love to make this world a better place for all of us, humans and animals. But, you know, you have a unique power, and please use it wisely.
Thank you. I will certainly do my best.
All right. Listen, everybody, I'm doing it for you, but that's a round of applause for Tiger Darrow and her trio, Sasha, Aya, and Lydia. So thank you so much. Now, moving swiftly on, I want to introduce a friend to Born Free, a great friend to Born Free, an actress who is, I'm sure, known to many, many of you. I'm not going to go through all her credits because she might actually tell you some of the things that she's been in. I turned on the TV 3 nights ago, and goodness me, there was Abigail Spencer in a film called This Is Where I Leave You with Jane Fonda. And Abigail, she's a remarkable person. I've had the great pleasure of meeting her several times. She came down to the English countryside with me and met my mum a year or two ago. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to the fabulous Abigail Spencer.
Hello, I'm Abigail Spencer, and welcome to my home, and thank you for being here tonight virtually in the midst of continuing COVID-19 global pandemia. I hope everyone in your life is healthy, safe, and well, and I hope you're all taking very good care of yourselves. Some of you might know me from the work I've done as an actor. I've been on shows like Suits. Anybody know Suits? I've been on Mad Men. Maybe that rings a bell. Also, I was on a show called Timeless for all the history buffs, and I have a new show on Hulu called Reprisal, and also a show on Amazon called Wayne. So, but if you don't know who I am, it's fine, but you can find me on those things. But maybe what you really don't know about me is that I am an animal advocate and supporter of Born Free USA, and I'm so deeply moved by all the work that they are doing around the world. I, like you, got to come to this event in the flesh a few years ago. My friend Mike Fisher brought me. Hello, Mike. Thank you. and was like, I think you're going to really be moved by the work that they're doing. I got to meet Will Travers. I then got to go to England and visit his dear, dear mother, Virginia. Hi, Virginia McKenna. At their home and break bread with them and talk about the deeper issues of what they are up against. So let me tell you a few more things you may not know. In the U.S., Born Free USA is working on critical wildlife issues, such as protecting the Endangered Species Act, campaigning to end indiscriminate trapping on 11.1 million acres of public land where it is now legal. They are ending the brutal and mostly hidden farming industry that inexplicably continues on in the United States, and they're giving more than 450 monkeys, many rescued from research labs, roadside zoos, or private homes, a second chance at life at the Born Free USA Primate Sanctuary. Now in West Africa, a hub for wildlife trafficking, Born Free USA is making a huge impact by helping governments and law enforcement officers catch and prosecute animal smugglers. Thank you, Born Free. I have hope for the future of wildlife because of the great work that Born Free USA is doing. I also have hope because all of you have taken time out of your busy schedules to join us tonight, and none of this could be possible without support from people like you. So thank you. If you're new, you know, join in and support us tonight. And if you have been supporting Born Free USA, thank you. And let's continue to do this great work together. Thank you, Virginia. Thank you, Will. And you guys have a great night.
Well, that's fantastic. Wise words from Abigail. And again, one day I hope to meet Abigail again, and we can talk about those issues that she mentioned. And Abigail inspires us, but moving from one talented individual to another talented individual, I would like now to introduce you to a very good friend of mine, Carla Fraser. And Carla is an actress, she's a producer, she's a writer, there she is, it's not a pre-record, it's live. So stand by for questions. She's a conservationist, an ambassador for animal charities, including Born Free and Born Free USA. Carla, I know that you were infatuated with animals from childhood. You became a vegan in your youth. You're now heavily involved in the whole sort of conservation and animal welfare movement. And one of the things you did, we've got two things we're going to discuss briefly. The first is that you made a short film called Grey Futures, or Grey Future. Tell everyone about Grey Future.
Good evening. It's so lovely to be here. I have been thoroughly enjoying it up until now. I've even had the tissues out. It's been absolutely amazing. Grey Future, right, I'm so glad Grey Future happened. What it was a short film that I made about elephants and rhinos and their plight. And it was basically coming from the angle of more of a dramatic angle rather than a documentary. So I went to drama school, trained as an actress, but I've always adored animals. And I never really knew how to merge the two. Having said that, I grew up watching Born Free on repeat with my grandma, also called Elsa. So the seed was somewhere in there. And whilst I was out in the acting world, and it isn't always easy, I suddenly had the idea for a short film that would be more suited for sort of Western audiences, and also to connect with the fact that the UK was sort of on the brink of discussing and looking at the concept of closing up the loopholes in the UK ivory trade, which was just such a shock to me that we were still involved in all of that and facilitating it. So I made a short film. It's basically about set in the future. It's a bit like a Black Mirror type thing, where it would be like my grandchildren not knowing exactly what an elephant or a rhino was, because the statistics were looking at that being something that could absolutely happen. And I thought if we came at it from that angle, where we looked at a future that we didn't want to be a future, at a time when we can do something, that could possibly be very emotive and give people a sense of ownership, because it can sometimes feel very heavy and it can feel like we've gone too far and there's no turning back. And this was sort of a way to say, here's what could happen. Let's not let that happen. And at the end of the film, there was a petition for the UK ivory trade and to tell our MPs that we wanted that shut down. And so it could link with that and really create some good. And since then, I got to meet you, Will, and do more involved with animals, and I've never really looked back.
Good thing. Not meeting me necessarily, but certainly the work for animals. But you're a real doer, Carla, because you know you see a story, you sort of picture a story, a sort of think like a director. You see a story and you go, that's a story that needs to be told. And then once you've got that idea, I know this from personal experience, you do not let go. We had lunch together in a vegan restaurant in London a while back, and you told me about this project called Wings. Mm-hmm. And I know that you told me that there were two young female characters in the story and then two old female characters in the story. And you told me that you had a really positive response from the wonderful Miriam Margolyes. For those who are Harry Potter fans, that's Professor Sprout in Harry Potter. And you were still looking for that second, more elderly actress to play the other role. And I said, do you know what? I think I know someone.
Yes.
Guess who?
I was like,
got put coffee everywhere. Tell us a little bit about this film, which you star in, and Virginia's in, and Miriam's in, and Rosie Day from Outland is in there as well. Just give us a taste, because you know there's a surprise, isn't there? Go on. There's two surprises.
Absolutely. So Wings is a short film about two Land Army girls during the World War II. The beginning of it is set in the 1940s, and it's set to a beautiful score. I don't want to ruin it because it is a short film, but essentially we see them years later, which is where we see the wonderful Virginia, which, can I just say, was just, I'll never get over the fact that she's in this story. And she plays alongside Miriam Margolyes. So it really is pretty magical.
We've got a clip.
Oh, of course. Sorry. Yes. I was just giving you a little bit of insight, but I have absolutely got a surprise for you. Here we go.
We'll meet again. For the first time, I don't know where, don't know when. We could be old, we could be gray, we could be comfortable. You could be gone, changing your name. Thought that you saw it all.
That has won a shedload of awards. I don't know if that expression is used in America, but in the UK you say it's won a shedload of awards, and it's out also on, I think, Channel 4 in the UK as well. But that's not the only surprise. Go on, surprise us again.
So I've got a very special little video for you from Miriam. Now, Miriam is absolutely thrilled that the tonight is happening, and she has sent us a little video. So we're going to play that for you now.
Hello, everybody. I'm Miriam Margolyes, and I'm welcoming you on behalf of Hope for Wildlife. It's a charity and a movement I believe in, and so does the wonderful Virginia McKenna, who was the star of Wings, the film that she and I made last year, which was so very special, which has won prizes all over the world. And we are very happy with it, rather proud of our performances. And I do hope that you'll be kind enough to donate in order to see the film and to remember animals throughout the world. Hope for Wildlife. And Virginia, as you know, has a foundation, the Born Free Foundation, and they've done magnificent work to take care of animals that would otherwise be extinct in Africa and all over the world. So when you put some money into Hope for Wildlife, you're making me happy, you're making Virginia happy, you're making Carla Fraser, who's the director of Wings, happy. In fact, everybody's having a very good time. I hope you are too. Please give generously. Thank you. Bye-bye.
I mean, seriously, how special and wonderful is that to have the great Miriam Margolyes send us that personal message, and as I say, or Professor Sprout, depending on your point of view. But that's fantastic. Carla, I unfortunately, time is so super short, but having you with us tonight is really special. Seeing your energy and your drive to make things better across a whole range of issues, whether it's wildlife or social issues or whatever, is hugely important. Do continue to do that fantastic work. And on behalf of our audience, I'm going to do this.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, everybody, hard to follow that, but believe it or not, we now have some more important and short messages from some key people. So all I will say to our tech team in the back, please roll the VT.
Hi, I'm Eric Beer. I'm an actor, and I lean on my experiences in relationship. Whether you've had the luck of being able to hang out with wild animals, or lay on the floor with your dog looking into each other's eyes, or had a baby fall asleep on your chest, or sit with a dying friend, you know that human beings are not unique on this planet in the ways that really matter. There are so many amazing animals out there in the world whose social and emotional lives we can't even begin to imagine. When it comes to taking care of the animal kingdom, to me, it's like noblesse oblige. We don't have to. There's nothing inherently right or wrong about it. But if we don't, then who will? That's the choice we get to make. I'd like to introduce you to some of my friends who've made this choice and stand for the animal kingdom, born free.
Hi, I'm Ellen. I'm an honorary council member of Born Free USA, and this is Goose. And we support the work that Born Free is doing around the world, keeping wild animals in the wild.
I'm Louise Linton, long-term animal advocate and friend to Born Free USA. I'm standing with Born Free to end trapping on public lands and to make wildlife refuges safer for people, pets, and wild animals.
Hi, I'm Elise. I run our Africa Conservation and Capacity Building Program at Born Free USA. We work in West Africa to equip countries to combat wildlife crime, and I'm very excited about the impact we're having on highly endangered species like lions, elephants, and pangolins.
Hi, I'm Anne Volkwine of Terra Conservation Initiative, and this is Mac. We stand with Born Free USA to safeguard the Endangered Species Act, the most powerful and important law that protects whales, lions, and pangolins, hopefully soon.
The Asian type and the African type.
That's right.
I am dedicated to providing the best possible veterinary care for the hundreds of monkeys at the Born Free USA Primate Sanctuary.
Hello, I'm Jessica Nelson. I'm a board member of Born Free USA, and I support Born Free USA's mission to help rescued monkeys live their best life in a sanctuary.
Hi, I'm Christine, and this is Vincent. I am standing with Born Free USA to safeguard the Endangered Species Act, the most powerful and effective wildlife conservation law that protects whales, lions, and hopefully soon all pangolin species.
Hi, I'm Michael. I'm a trustee of Born Free USA, and I support our work to end illegal animal trafficking and to keep wildlife where it belongs, in the wild.
Hi, I'm Ginny, and I'm a member of the Born Free Honorary Board Council. And what do I love most about the organization is that they are so relentless and tireless in their pursuit of advocating on behalf of animals that do not have a voice.
Well, yeah, those are some fantastic comments from a range of people, many of whom you may have heard of, our board members, our honorary council, some of our key members of the team. I'm really pumped up when I hear what they've got to say. And I have to say, as a Brit living over here, I wish we had an Endangered Species Act. I wish we had what you have in the USA, the most powerful piece of legislation to protect species on the planet. Heaven forbid that that is ever weakened, because we are so jealous of you. Now, I just want to remind you of our different donation levels. And I didn't mention, but luckily I'm prompted because it's right there on the screen. If you want to see Wings, that short film with Miriam and Virginia and the rest of a wonderful cast, it's a short film. And if you make a donation of $50, you will be given access for 48 hours only to the full length short film. So please think about that. If you are pledging more than 150, you get the signed and personalized copy of The Life in My Years, my mum's. I've read it. I actually waited 3 years after she'd written it before I read it, because I knew it was going to be a very personal read. And it is a very good book. And I'm not just saying that because I'm being paid. I mean, because I'm her son. Oops. if you make a donation of 250, you get the framed digital wildlife primate or animal print picture by Dr. Liz Tyson, our very own Dr. Liz Tyson. Don't forget, there's the details at the top of the screen of how you can make a donation. If it's $500, it could be your custom framed digital pet. And what I should now say, of course, is that while the top dog, as it were, in that photograph is Romy, the dog who lives with us here in England, the other companion animal there belongs to Carla. So Carla got a bit of a surprise probably when she saw that. $1,000, you can have a virtual cup of tea with Liz, or you can have a virtual cup of tea with me, or if you decide to go crazy, and why not, spend $2,000, maybe we can have a virtual cup of tea together, which would be extremely elegant and rather refined, if I may say so myself. And for $5,000, you could get that trip for two, internal US air travel coach, two nights accommodation, and a really exclusive and extraordinary opportunity to learn about the work of Born Free USA and the Primate Sanctuary firsthand from Dr. Liz Tyson. So there is a fabulous thing. If you haven't got that much, come on, everybody. Here are my bananas. You can't have them because I'm going to have them for dinner later. But what you can do is you can just make a donation. And we, if it's a $25 donation, we will put that towards buying bananas for all the primates down in the primate sanctuary. And let's think about it. If 100 people give $25, we're gonna buy $2,500 worth of bananas and make their holiday season just that little bit extra special. Now, as we run right up against the clock, I want to welcome back Angela and Liz, and they're going to say a few words.
Thank you, Will. Thanks for joining us again, Liz. I want to bring in one of our honorary council members who was able to join us today. You saw Eric Bear in the beginning of that last video montage. He had the wonderful technology with the monkey and delivered a really compelling message. Eric, I think you had a question for us.
Hey guys, are we live?
I can't believe
we installed Zoom in the sanctuary. It's so amazing.
It's gonna be the monkey.
Liz. Oh my gosh, Will, I can taste the lion in the background. Angela. Well, look, hey, guys, you know, on behalf of all of the monkeys down here at the sanctuary, you know, we don't often get to see you people. But, and you know, we're vulnerable. We, you know, we need you. We need your support. And we're so appreciative. And I just wanted to say thank you on behalf of all of us down here, that your stewardship and your care means a lot. Thank you.
Oh, Eric, thank you. That was brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
That was amazing. I had no idea you were going to be the one.
No idea. No idea. I'm I'm all right. I'm okay, actually, Eric. I'm okay.
Oh, goodness. That was really wonderful. Well, thank you, Eric. And I'd like to thank our wonderful host committee, board members, the entire board and honorary council, Will, Liz, Carla Frazier, Abigail, James, and You Are Life for all of their work on the videos that you saw today. Karen and Melissa behind the scenes making this all happen, and everyone who contributed to this event. We have some wonderful gifts for the levels of donations that you saw. Any donation of any size makes a big difference in our ability to not only care for the animals that we've rescued at our primate sanctuary, but to end the cruelty and the practices that make a sanctuary like ours and our work in general possible. So please give as generously as you can. You can do that at bornfreeusa.org/hope. You can also pledge right there in the chat if you'd like to let us know any last minute questions or details. And another thanks to Tiger Darrow for performing live. And to all of you, our supporters and advocates who save lives of animals and give the world hope for wildlife. Thank you for joining us today.
Well, thank you, Angela, and thank you, Liz. I'm just going to add my own short closing remarks. I mean, what an outstanding evening. And there are some other thank yous that I think, in addition to all these incredible positive voices that we've heard, whether it's Virginia or Abigail or Miriam, Tiger and the Trio, Carla, Rocky, and then our honorary council, Eric, Ellen, Louise, Anne, Ginny, and then our board members who are here with us, Jessica, Sean, Michael, and others, thank you so much. But I really want to finish seriously by saying a huge thank you to the Born Free team. Born Free USA is an outstanding organization. I'm super proud to be a board member. That's Angela, it's Liz, who you've heard from, it's Dr. J, who you saw, Melissa, Karen, Alice, Aurora, Julie, Barry, Suzanne, Rebecca, all our primate caregivers. Who cannot feel hope for wildlife after an event like this? And what, of course, gives me hope is all of you who've tuned in this evening, who've taken part in your own way, sent lovely messages. I've been watching the chat, have pledged funds and support for the incredible ongoing work that Angela's mentioned. Each and every one of you is a wildlife hero this evening. Your commitment, your passion, your compassion, and your generosity. You know what? We can save the world, one animal at a time. Thank you very much indeed, and I hope to see you again soon.
Thank you, everyone.